Welcome, everyone. This is the panel on News Beyond Advertising. I'm glad to see that I'm not the only person at this conference who's absolutely obsessed with money, who think about money every day, because I care about journalism, and I think journalists should be paid. And for someone to pay them, there has to be a funding model of some sort, and that's what we're going to talk about here with a fantastic panel of people who have different perspectives and experiences in thinking about funding models for news, what they were, where they are, and where they might be in the future. My name is Rasmus Nielsen. I'm a director of research at the Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism at the University of Oxford. We have a mid-career fellowship program for journalists from all over the world and also do research that we rather immodestly perhaps aim to be timely and relevant for people like yourself who are doing incredibly important and challenging things in a rapidly changing and uncertain environment. And we have a fantastic panel of people who, unlike myself, have practical experience. So I'll ask each of them just to briefly introduce themselves, and then we will kick off with some remarks from the panel and then open up for questions and discussion with all of those of you who have decided to come here after lunch or who follow this online. So, Aron?
Sure. Yeah, so I'm Aron Pilhofer. I have to go slow, the James B. Steele Chair in Journalism Innovation at Temple University. That just rolls off the tongue. I specialize there in data journalism and in new business models. And in my previous 12-ish years, I was a journalist for about 25 years, all told, but my previous 12, I spent in dual roles across the business side and in the newsroom. And so I'm not gonna take a lot of time because I think this should be more conversational, but just a few sort of random observations about where we are and where things are headed. I think everyone knows, everyone has seen, particularly on the print side, the direction of travel. Print advertising continues to fall. It continues to fall at a rapid pace, and I think the acceleration is only gonna continue. We've seen that consistently. It's consistent across just about every continent. It's consistent across just about every segment. Digital advertising of late, 2015, I think, was the inflection point where digital advertising, display advertising anyway, shifted dramatically. At The Guardian, we had projected a 10% increase in digital advertising and saw a 3% decrease. The New York Times has seen the same thing, and it's been repeated across every major news organization who has to report. Gannett, Tronc, everyone is seeing the same thing. So I guess am I supposed to be talking or just introducing? Sorry, dude.
It's a really compelling introduction, but it really was meant to be an introduction.
Oh,
yes.
Oh. So. I'll save my remarks for later then. let's put a bookmark in that. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. I could listen to you talk all day, so I have no problem. My name is Vivian Schiller, and I think that in my various incarnations in my career, I've touched every form of revenue for news that exists. So I was at CNN with the cable model and the television advertising model. I was at the New York Times with Aron, where you have print subscription, digital subscription, we'll talk about it later, I'm no doubt, display advertising. I was at NPR, which had a variety of, as the CEO of NPR, where we had philanthropic giving, we had membership, we had sponsorship. I was at NBC News, which is broadcast model, again, very different form of revenue for news. And I was at Twitter, which is an entirely other form of revenue. So I look at, since we're talking about money, I don't usually look at my career through the lens of business models, but seemed appropriate at this point. And now I'm doing a variety of things. I'm an advisor to news organizations. I'm also working with brands, which we'll talk about, I'm sure, more. So I sort of see things from the other side. as well as I'm on the Scott Trust, which oversees the Guardian. So there's some interesting things going on there too.
Hello, I'm Renée Kaplan. So
Now it's on. Thank you. I'm Renée Kaplan. So I'm first and foremost a journalist in the bigger picture, and more specifically, I am at the Financial Times, where I'm the head of audience engagement, which justifiably you may have no idea what it is. But it is directly related to the transformation of the business model in news journalism, in media in general. So more about that later.
Hi, so I'm Turi, Munthe, and I've been involved in all sorts of different forms of media. Journalism I was terrible at, a terrible, terrible journalist, never understood how to find a story. But a lot of opinion pieces, which is great because I'm now up here with being able to perform them. In 2007, having played a lot of different roles across lots of different kinds of media, publishing, TV, political analysis and everything else, I founded a company called Demotics, and Demotics ended up becoming, I suppose, the biggest network of photojournalists in the world, citizen journalism, and then upgraded. And I sold that in 2012-13. So from being a terrible journalist, I became a sort of accidentally successful entrepreneur in the tech world, not being able to code. You can tell the people who can't code here because they're not dressed in T-shirts. That's quite...
I can't code, and yet.
You can code.
I cannot code, but evidently I must be able to learn.
And now what we do is, so with three partners, we founded a VC fund, which invests in media against all odds. And we invest in media technology which helps accelerate or monetize some of the key trends that we see across media generally. And we also invest in actual media. Our focus is media, particularly in what we call growth markets which are determined by large populations, youth bulge, complacent old-style media companies, so space to grow, and very fast-growing internet and mobile penetration.
So I wanted to make a few sort of general observations before we return to people's experience and perspectives and extended leads, which is, first of all, I mean, just to state the sort of what might be obvious to you in the room, but that I think bears repeating, is that journalism is, no matter how idealistic and principled the motivations for doing journalism, journalism is a profession. It's not an avocation. People who do journalism quite reasonably want to be paid for it so that they can make a living. And they may not want a lot of money, but they should be supported for their work. And historically, in almost every country, a large part of that funding has come from advertising historically in the 19th and particularly the 20th century. The U.S. probably the most extreme example of this, that at the sort of the commercial high point of U.S. newspapers in the 90s, something like 90% of revenues came from advertising. Many other markets have had a much more balanced split between reader revenues and advertising revenues, but even if advertising was only half your revenues, that's still half. And it's clear, as Aron indicated, that advertisers are moving their money elsewhere, and quite sensibly so. Indeed, judging by my Facebook feed, newspapers themselves have realized that Google and Facebook are very effective platforms for advertising. So no wonder that other advertisers have come to the same conclusion. These are companies that provide great solutions to the problems that advertisers want solved. We can also see the problem that audiences increasingly are fed up with the forms of advertising that publishers have relied upon online, with the rise of ad blockers. So even though publishers still have a share of digital advertising, it's clear that there is a problem in the ways in which it's being served and that people aren't particularly fond of the formats used. And I think that leaves us in a position where, with a few exceptions, and some of you may be working in those companies, I think we probably have to confront the fact that most journalism can't count on advertising as the primary source of funding moving forward. And that raises a huge question. You know, where is any money going to come from then? We have more and more people who are looking at pay models of various sorts, whether they are sort of clearly commercial, subscription-based ones, or slightly more solidarity-based forms of donation or membership or the like. So pay is clearly one thing people are looking at. We've got a lot of work on branded branded content, sponsored content, native advertising, which a lot of journalists are very uncomfortable with, but is a growth area for a lot of organizations. Not an easy one, I think we should add very quickly. And we also have all these things that some journalists love and other things are silly distractions. Events, merchandise, e-commerce, all sorts of other revenue streams that people are experimenting with. But I think we need to just sort of step back for a minute and think about what the alternative is to really developing new commercial models for journalism, which is that with the decline of the existing business models, we might think that this is simply about the decline of a previously profitable industry as we move from a low-choice environment in which a few media organizations had market power because they controlled the channels that many advertisers relied on, to a high-choice environment in which advertisers have many opportunities, and a few of those very, very big opportunities are very cheap and very efficient and can offer scale that no one can compete with, that this is simply about efficiency in a way, a change, a structural change in the economy. And that's part of the story, an important part of the story, and one that journalism has to contend with. But there are two other sides to this story that I think are worth keeping in mind, and these are things that are perhaps in some ways more powerfully illustrated across Europe and other parts of the world at a genuinely international festival like this than they are in the US, at least in living memory, which is there have been other reasons for investing in professional journalism than the for-profit motivations of commercial news organizations. And the two other reasons are public service, whether based on philanthropy or donations from individual members, the sort of NPR has worked with it, or the collectively binding decisions behind something like a license fee funding model at the BBC, for example. So public service. And then there is the other one that we hear about at quite a lot of the panels here, but not always the same panels that talk about technology and money, which is power. People invest in journalism because they want to exercise power. This can be for reasons that you might think of as principled and benign. The abolitionist movement in the US invested in newspapers. Trade unions have invested in newspapers. Many different kinds of political actors and social movements have invested in news and journalism as a way of fighting for the principles and interests that they cared about. It can also be for somewhat more self-serving reasons, whether in the form of state-controlled propaganda organs or media that are owned and operated by conglomerates who have politically sensitive business interests, real estate, extractive industries, telecoms, people who extract rent from the state. So powerful politicians with diverse business interests who also happen to own media. We are in Italy. And as the commercial model declines, I think there is a real question in many countries about whether, in parallel with that decline, we will see a rise of these other reasons. Public service, perhaps, but slightly more worryingly, power, propaganda. And the reason I say that is that this, I think, is one of the reasons why a lot of journalists are not particularly keen to necessarily think about or talk about the business side or the financial underpinnings of what they do. But this specter, this shadow of the resurgence of these like very instrumentalized propagandistic organs that are funded by other interests for other reasons, I think that is one of the key reasons why I think it's critically important that journalists engage with this question of what does the business or the funding models of journalism look like after advertising? If you can no longer take for granted that a department store or a bank or a car manufacturer will subsidize what you do, what does it look like then, whether it's on a market basis or some other basis? And that's what I hope we can have a discussion about today with the different perspective from the panel, and again, then with the perspectives from the people who have come today. So Aron, I interrupted you very rudely. Why don't we resume?
So anyway. If the title, just a few thoughts, kind of almost randomly, if the title of this panel is, you know, sort of thinking about news after advertising, I sort of have to ask, actually I want to sort of go to extend from a conversation I was having earlier today, is I think we actually have to think about the cost of advertising to whatever is next. Advertising and a lot of the models that we're going to talk about here today, in particular membership models, models that are about direct revenue, those models aren't necessarily compatible with the traditional advertising model, particularly when you start injecting things like native advertising or even worse, sort of native advertising platforms like Outbrain or Taboola into the mix. people will pay for news. They absolutely will. It's been proven. They'll pay for news when they find value, when that news, when the thing that they are getting is sufficiently differentiated, when they find it essential to their life. And when you log on to a page, and I don't want to, I'm not going to pick on CNN Money, but I will pick on CNN Money just a bit. I would just encourage you to, it just happens to be one of the examples, most egregious, I think, examples of where an organization is clearly sacrificing short-term revenue for, I would argue, long-term trust, authority, value. There is not a single ad platform left behind. There's Taboola, at least three Taboola modules. There's paid modules. There are things that take you off to native advertising. There's autoplay video that auto plays an ad. It's like, you know, it's just one of those. It's sort of as bad as it could possibly get. And if the future is indeed more about direct support from readers, viewers, then I think we really are hurting ourselves in the long run by trying to maximize what we can get in the short term. And I think there's a huge cost to that. The other piece I'll throw out there is that I think journalists, and I think this is a point that you're going to hear again and again today, unfortunately, now in the last 10 years, every journalist's job has changed. You're asked to do more. You're asked maybe to shoot photographs. You're asked maybe to shoot video. You're asked maybe to podcast. You're asked to post on social. The job just keeps growing and growing and growing and growing. And unfortunately, sadly, perhaps tragically, I want to add just one more to that. I really believe that we fundamentally have to have a role in determining the next business model, whatever that is. Or at least a voice in the direction, the strategic direction that news organizations are taking today. Because fundamentally, this has not been part of our job. And journalists in general just don't understand how organizations make money. I didn't. I thought I did. And then I went into an actual business side job during my last year at The Guardian. Sat across from one of our senior ad sales executives who was passionately imploring me to create some product and dev time to implement header bidding. I let her go for 5 minutes before I stopped her and I said, I have to ask you something right now. What the fuck is header bidding? Had no idea. But the point is, and I actually had talked with Jeff Jarvis about this, and if this is of interest to anybody in the room, I'd love to talk to you about it later. I think there should be a curriculum. I think there should actually be a curriculum to teach journalists like how news organizations make money, and it could be delivered actually on an organization by organization level, a general curriculum. But it's just an idea. But if it's something that's of interest to you, I'd love to talk to you about it afterwards. And I think I'll leave it at that.
Well, the very first point I was going to make is the one that you just made, which is about how it's worth repeating again, and I just want to add, I won't repeat what you said about how critical it is for all journalists to make sure, put upon themselves if their organization is not, to deeply understand the business models for their organizations and other organizations as well. Aron said it very well. I'd only add one other thing that you didn't mention, but I'm sure you agree with, which is, there are still, shockingly to me, some pockets of resistance towards this, not because of people being overworked, which they are, but because somehow it is considered antithetical to journalism, that if I understand how the money is made, therefore that is the only obvious end to that slippery slope is, you know, selling stories to advertisers, which of course is nonsense, and that, well, let me be clear. It's not nonsense we should not be selling stories to advertisers. I mean, it's nonsense that understanding, taking it upon yourself to understand the business is sort of the road to hell. So I just want to add that point. I won't belabor it, though I suspect many of us will have the same things. So I just want to make a few points. They don't necessarily all tie together. And it's really in response to things that I hear all the time. Number one, whatever revenue models that we used to love from the past are not coming back. I feel ridiculous having to say this out loud, but I need to say it out loud because there is still pockets of people who think we just have to like wait this out. It's amazing. The second is there is no, in looking for the new model, there is no singular new model that is going to take the place of the old model. It is going to be different for every organization and is generally not going to be this, you know, classic, how wonderful that it was, dual revenue stream that, you know, cable television enjoyed, that newspapers enjoyed, that radio enjoyed. It is now going to be a mix of revenue models. I will say that I think if you look across sort of different kinds of publishers, that the organizations on either end, and I'll explain what I mean by either end, are in a better position than the people in the middle. By either end, I mean, on the one hand, super small and targeted. There's really interesting opportunities there. I'll name two examples that both have different models that are succeeding very well. One is, I don't know if people here are familiar with it, The Information, which is a super high-priced subscription. I mean, super high-priced in the... It's a digital publication. I think it costs about $400 a year, if I'm not mistaken. Is that right? Yeah. And they have... It's not covering the landscape. It is pretty targeted, very in-depth journalism about sort of the technology and media ecosystem. And they are succeeding. They make money. They don't have a big staff because it has become, it was founded by a reporter from the Wall Street Journal. They have become must-read, and they can command those kinds of revenues. Another model, very small and targeted, they don't charge a dime for readership, is a small targeted digital publication called Skift. So Skift was founded by Rajat, what's Rajat's last name again? I've suddenly forgotten. Anyway, sorry, I'm looking at you like you have to have the answers. Anyway, never mind that. So Skift is super targeted. It is about the travel industry. Couldn't be more targeted. But they have, in a very short time, they own it. And their revenue model is around events. They do have some advertising. But because they're so targeted, they have been able to sort of capture the entire, all of the media around the travel business in a way because they're so focused and they own it. So it's the big swath. And then the other end of that spectrum are the big, high reputation, you know, organizations like the New York Times, like the FT, like the Washington Post, who can, because they are considered so indispensable and they are very broad, they can charge subscriptions. I worry, or meter, or we can get into detail about that later. That wasn't the point I wanted to make, is all the different incarnations of paid. I worry about everybody in the middle, which includes, by the way, local news organizations, who are not going to be able to, you and I may disagree, are going to have a really hard time making enough money, paying for access, but are not so targeted and focused that they can sort of make money and they're small enough around the fringes. So, and then I just want to take a quick, can I have just a couple more minutes? I just want to take a quick run on just an inventory of the different revenue models and offer a couple of opinions about them, which I'm quite sure not everybody will agree with, but I'm going to say them anyway. I'm not going to go on about ads because you guys have covered that well, but I do want to say something about branded because I'm not opposed to branded. And by branded content, sponsored content, that is funded by advertisers, in the interest of advertisers, I'm not talking about Taboola and Outbrain and these other native things. I'm talking about the things like T-Studio at the New York Times, who create big ticket content packages for advertisers that actually provide that. So here, my criteria is they absolutely must make it clear and clear and clear again that it is not editorial driven content, that is funded by an advertiser, and it is approved and, you know, from beginning to end by the advertiser. And it has to add value to the reader. And as long as those two things are met, I think it's great. I think it's a new revenue stream. It's very hard, as you said. Everybody sort of jumped on the bandwagon and thought, well, this isn't necessarily going to be so easy. But I have no problem with it, and I know many journalists do. Philanthropy, I was very deeply involved with this at NPR. It is a long slog to get big ticket funders from individual philanthropists. For foundations, it's a little bit easier, but it's also very difficult. There is no magic bullet there.
I'm going very quickly because I know we want to move on to other things. Donation and membership also sounds very easy. It is tough. Public radio has honed this over decades and decades of learning, specifically around understanding the public radio audience, what they respond to. I mean, this is so much, decades and decades across hundreds of stations. And even there, public radio does not crack 10% of listeners. Only 10 to 12% of listeners, this is consistently for years, will give. It's not bad, it's good money, but it's just an important point. Micro payments, I'm extremely skeptical. I support it. I want to believe in it. I just have a hard time believing in it. I'm almost done. Two more. Government funding, I know that is a time-honored tradition in much of Europe. It seems to work for the BBC. I think it is, and this is where I really differ from so many of my former public broadcasting and public media cables. I think accepting money from the federal government in America for public media news is a really bad idea, and they have got to get out. Now, Trump is trying to make it easier by pulling the funding. Strangely, I find myself agreeing with the ultra-conservatives about the funding not going to journalism, but for completely different reasons. Let me just be clear, completely different reasons. And lastly, I think the absolute best model, if you can get it, is the billionaire model. That is the best revenue model of all.
Okay.
The benign billionaire funding model, I am somewhat skeptical. Can I just say very briefly on Vivian's point about the necessity of repeating some of these points? There is not a week in my life where there isn't normally a man in his 60s in a suit who asks me whether I believe that the decline of print is slowing down and whether young people won't at least read print newspapers over the weekends. And we are in for a world of pain if you leave business decisions to people like that. You need to be part of those conversations.
Not that there's anything wrong with being 60, just with not that have that attitude.
I don't want to be ageist. There's a
pattern. So I'll take a slightly different approach. I think you've heard a lot about different kinds of business models, which is actually fascinating because being able to get the toolkit of potential options is rare, and Vivian really has that kind of perspective, as does Aron, having been on both sides of the business. I'm going to talk a little bit more about how changing business models are actually changing the newsroom and the journalism. So the Financial Times does not have the billionaire model, although we probably have billionaire subscribers, because it is a highly premium product. But the fact that there's now something called audience engagement, and so it's a team in the newsroom that's a mixture of digital journalists and data analysts and other people whose job it is now to optimize the content. And optimizing the content is, again, a whole thing born of this transitioning business model where we're no longer in a regime where most news media has been financed by advertising. You've heard it before. And increasingly, we can't rely on that. And we can't rely on it at all for some models. For the Financial Times, for example, the third quarter of last year was the beginning of an incredibly drop off the cliff where print advertising revenue dipped by double digits. And it's still dipping by double digits. And the good news is that, well, it's not 25%, but it's still in double digits. So that means that, you know, the Financial Times is always charged for its content, unlike other news media models. So we have the advantage of understanding what a subscription model is, what getting readers to pay for content is. The big shift now, though, is that before it was part of our business model. Now we are dependent on a business model in which we have to get readers to pay for our content. So what does that mean? Well, that means that completely changes the relationship of a news brand to its audience, hence head of audience engagement. But more seriously, the idea that there is a relationship at all for a lot of news media, especially legacy news media, is new. And the big transformation is from one of kind of a come to us, take it or leave it, because we're financed by advertising model, like what you get, pay for it, don't like it, go elsewhere, to one of actually, we have to think about you and come to you. We have to understand more and more about what you are willing to pay for and what that looks like and feels like and who you are, because if you don't pay for it, we go away. So in some ways, it's about this shifting relationship. Depending on how you view relationships, it's essentially a shifting of balance of power. where before it really was from broadcaster to audience, and now it's more the audience who has a real say in the matter to some extent. And the say in the matter is basically, as news media, we have to understand more and more about what value looks and feels like. The good news is that we are able to understand what value looks and feels like. The bad news is that great journalism, which most legacy news media know how to do, is not enough. It's just not enough anymore. That's kind of the unglamorous reality, where you can have the most amazing reporters and the breaking news stories and an expertise that goes back, in the case of the Financial Times, over 150 years. That's not enough anymore to get people to pay for content, because none of this has to be great journalism. It has to be something that's thinking about utility and service and usage and the right format in the right place at the right time. Understanding audiences is a lot more about understanding in what way they're going to be willing to pay for your content, and in what way means on mobile, in the morning on their commute, on what topics, in which language, in which kind of geo-targeted way you need to be thinking about getting your content in front of them. So, obviously, this is all related to the business model, but it's also now related to the way we're actually commissioning and distributing and producing the journalism. And it means understanding a little bit about more about our audiences, so that's data related. It's understanding a little bit about how fast we have to go and change. And again, this is, you know, as everyone was saying this panel before, newsrooms, especially legacy newsrooms, don't necessarily like change. Journalism is actually something that's deeply rooted in tradition, in the way of doing good reporting. And change, however, has to happen pretty fast when there is this kind of double-digit drop in advertising revenue. So a newsroom and a newsroom understanding that change is not only necessary, but good for them, and that actually they can be part of the change, and that collaborating in an understanding of what the right format looks like, or of what a new distribution model looks like, not chafing against all the asks that Aron was talking about, all of these sort of, gosh, now I have to like do the reporting and get the story out and think about tweeting it and think about what time to publish it and thinking about the extra content that looks good and thinking about the interactivity. And actually, before I even do the commissioning, I'm probably to think about the format and who the audience is. Yeah, all of that is part of the journalist job, and there's help, but that needs to be integrated into the way we're doing journalism. That needs to be baked in if we are going to be remotely competitive in a world in which there is no longer a business model that is part of the whole way we had been doing journalism. Finally, a couple last points about where the FT actually is with things. So here is an incredibly premium product, right? So not only do we have to get people to pay for our content, we have to get them to pay a lot. The information costs a lot of money, the FT costs more. So the question of really what gives people value is incredibly important, because we're asking them to give us a lot. The good news is that right now, we've actually crossed the sort of magic threshold where here was an illustrious newspaper that was dependent over 80% on advertising revenue. Now more than 60% of our revenue comes from the content. So that's a mixture of digital sales, it's a mixture of branded content, it's a mixture of a lot of the stuff. But basically, we're getting people to actually pay for our content, and it's subsidizing by over 60% the business model. So it's possible. Finally, journalists are helping us think this through. We're actively calling on the newsroom to help us think about, in a very crass way, journalists don't really like to think about money, and to some extent we've protected ourselves from thinking about money. But at the core, yeah, even though great journalism is not enough, that's still what we're in the business of producing. And nobody knows good content and great journalism better than journalists. So if we're having to think about how to get readers to pay more for really good content, nobody's better placed to do that than our journalists. So we've just launched a new premium product. It's a newsletter exclusively for our subscribers that basically gives insider scoops on mergers and acquisitions deals. This was thought of by the newsroom. We are doing a lot more to grow our women readership. It's not something we're really good at the FT. Women don't particularly read us. They don't find us relevant. They're kind of 50% of the population. That's called a business opportunity. So we're getting our journalists to think about, well, we know that women actually are really time poor. So what does a product look like in terms of the content? How do we deliver stories to them? In what format do we need to be creating content so that people who are especially time poor, like women, are likely to get it and engage with it and eventually pay for it? And finally, it ultimately comes down to the fact that in almost every newsroom and every major news media, including probably all the ones that we represent at this table, right now we are all losing headcount. If you are still in a newsroom or want to get into a newsroom, you have to be thinking about how you are going to bring value to your audience and get them to pay for what you're doing.
Thanks so much. So as I said earlier, North-based Media, which is our fund, invests in media companies but in growth markets. And so we come at it from a slightly different perspective. One, the markets that we're investing in are essentially new. I mean, they're far, far newer in the digital space. And two, the companies that we're investing in are startups, which means they get to sort of start from scratch. Talk about the markets briefly. The Middle East, which is one of the areas of focus for us, the Middle East in 2015, market of 400 million people, less than 1% of the web in Arabic. Digital advertising revenue across the whole of the Middle East was just over $500 million in 2015, which is 45 times less per capita than the UK. Which means that from our perspective, and that's just one example, ditto Latin America, ditto Southeast Asia, and India, we're going to see huge growth there. So from our perspective, what we're looking for are media companies. Again, I'm going to come to the startup point. We're looking for companies that can surf this wave, this enormous opportunity, this very fast rising tide, and become what we hope generational players in those markets. The advantage that those companies have is that they get to figure out what their business model is from scratch. They don't sit there with gigantic staff. They don't sit there with pensions. They don't sit there with all the wonderful things that big media companies have got and continue to do, and because you have to negotiate while producing amazing content. They get to start from scratch. I have to agree with all the points which were made here around the way you understand value. So the companies that we end up looking at, the companies that we like, the value that we see in them is in two areas. The successful companies are, one, laser-sharp focus. They know exactly what they're doing. They know the market that they're talking to. They know the voice that they're bringing. And data. Data is sort of the definer of success for the digital media companies that we look at. And there's a way of understanding data, which is, again, value. It's asking what the audience want. And for forever, media companies have been able to talk from on high to audiences that they hardly knew and get away with it because they were essentially monopolies. That's so not the case anymore that it becomes, from our perspective, the core driver in a sense of even our investment thesis. How smart are these new media companies at understanding what their audience want at a level of granularity which has never before been possible? So perhaps because of the markets that we focus in, I should say that we still believe in advertising. We think advertising has got a long way to go. It's going to change shape. We're going to see a lot more native. We see a lot more native. We see it. We're going to see a lot more targeted advertising. One of the things which fascinates me is a few companies we've seen that have they're Facebook native. They're essentially media publishers on Facebook. They've been using engagement on Facebook to understand their audience and build huge data models around their audience purely from the engagement on Facebook. What that allows them to do is to hyper-customize delivery across Messenger when Messenger gets there. We're going to see the same thing. That, from our perspective, is a huge new opportunity in terms of revenue and around advertising. More sponsorship, more local. One of the things which we also feel is that there is a huge raft. I'm just sticking to advertising because I don't want to get to post-advertising quite yet. But we think that there is an enormous base of local businesses that do not yet know how to advertise digitally. And there's the beginning of tech that's helping people to do that. But again, we think there's a real opportunity there. And then subs. High-level subs in all their forms. Again, if you're delivering really valuable information, it can be at a very large scale like the FT, or it can be super niche. to Aaron's point, people will pay. People will pay for that kind of information. What becomes subsequently interesting, I suppose, from our perspective, is whether any other big platforms pick up and start getting involved in the subs game. And this is, I think I'll end here. One of the questions that I think a lot of us have had for a long time is, how come the telcos seem so dumb? Why are the telcos, which are sitting on insane, incomparable amounts of money, how have they not moved into this space? How do they not understand that there is an opportunity here? The experiences up till now have predominantly been not around news. They've been around music, for example. So telcos bundling in Spotify to ensure that they differentiate against the competition in their markets. But I wonder whether there's not a big new opportunity in that kind of world too. We go back to a fundamental point, which has always been the case with journalism, which is that the Baghdad Bureau doesn't pay for itself. It never has. It really never has at all. So how do telcos rethink the whole bundling model around content?
So I'm very keen we get a chance to get some questions and comments from the floor, but as people sort of collect their thoughts, maybe just a brief gloss before we open it up. I think we can see a couple of things that are happening clearly, right? Which one of which is a increasing polarization between those who pursue high value added niche products, normally primarily based around some sort of pay proposition, and then those who are pursuing scale and volume and still primarily on the advertising game. I think the sort of the second order comment on that is that we probably are in a position where we need to reconsider what we mean by volume and scale, because the biggest players in the advertising game are unimaginably bigger than any publisher. So the question of what chasing scale looks like when there are a handful of companies out there that are vastly bigger and have vastly more data and more locked-in users and more products and more touch points with people than anything any publisher can realistically expect to achieve anytime in the near future is, I think, a question that is relevant even in those markets where there is very real growth ahead, which is very much true in India, for example, but there is still a question, you know, will those companies that dominate the digital advertising market and other markets, will they dominate as much in those growth markets as they already do in more mature markets? The second point I want to make, just that this is sort of one of those things where this might sound very academic for people who are living through this transition in a very accelerated way from day to day, is that nothing happens overnight. And that's not just a historical observation to say that we should remember that the increase of pay subscription for newspapers, for example, historically didn't happen from one day to another. It took 20, 30, 40 years for American newspapers to come out of the penny press revolution to really build very high national circulation. These things have never happened overnight. The same thing with growth in advertising. These things do not happen overnight. And that's not necessarily sort of actionable on a day-to-day basis as you are struggling in your job to sort of see the road ahead necessarily or trying to build a business. But it's important to keep that in mind, that pessimism of the intellect is paralyzing and therefore it's also useless. We have to be optimists, and there is an advertising component in the future, and there is a pay subscription component to the future, and we see this in market after market, that there are people out there who will pay for news and that there are people who will donate to support news. And as Vivian said, that too is not a quick fix, but it's doable. If you put your mind to it, there is work that can be done in that space too. Let's take some questions from the floor. We have some wonderful people with mics who will be moving around. Let's start from the top.
Hi. So all these different revenue models sound great, and there's definitely going to be a mix, but it looks like the only one at the moment that seems to have a good prospect of supporting large-scale, broad-based publications is a paid subscription model, and there's a lot of momentum towards that in the newspaper industry. But obviously, we're living in an increasingly polarized world, and that's been identified as a problem. And if only people who can pay will have access to those broad-based, high-quality, you know, things like the Washington Post, the New York Times, the Financial Times, and everyone else is either going to be relying upon people who are just pursuing power or, you know, maybe philanthropic efforts, but and maybe state TV if they're lucky. Aren't we going to contribute to a segregated information environment where only those who can afford to pay can actually access high quality information, the information they need to play a proper part in society and make good decisions?
I'm going to take a stab at that. I think that's a very real risk. And I think one of the defining issues that we face as societies is not so much necessarily the whole filter bubble and echo chamber discussion as much as the question of a polarization between people who care an awful lot about news and are willing to pay for it with attention but also with money, and those who care less and are not bad people for that reason but are just less engaged and often also less affluent and less willing to pay for news. One political response to that question has been public service media, which are free at the point of consumption, though everybody pays, and if you don't, you go to jail, which is a pretty robust business model. Nice job if you can get it. I think that it's also, though, to sort of, you know, borrow a phrase from Renée that I think is a good one that journalists can think about in addition to people who are running the business side, is you can flip that on the head and say, is that a business opportunity? Is it right now sort of is the red ocean right now that everyone is barging in sort of to the high-end, affluent, well-educated, white male audience? And is there a pay product that looks different, that is catered towards a different audience? I'm just back from a trip to Hong Kong and Singapore, and what publishers there say is that they're basically looking at whether Facebook and Google and other platforms from the Western world will up their game and catch up with the mainland Chinese platform companies that already enable micro-commerce on a very large scale. So micropayments that are not premised on every user creating an account with every provider, but by a platform that facilitates micro-payments. And a lot of that stuff is stuff that I think we would think of as very tabloid journalism, more tabloid content. So I'm not entirely convinced that the business opportunities only lie at the affluent end of the market. I think most of them probably do, but maybe there is an opportunity for a blue ocean move that does things differently.
So one of the things that fascinates me is the idea of a combination between one of the tech companies and a news company. So Vivian, I wonder if when you were at Twitter, if they ever considered merging with or buying a news organization. I just checked the market caps. New York Times is worth, Twitter is worth about three times what the New York Times is. And Twitter's struggling now.
Yeah.
So what would that look like? What if, I'm assuming that you didn't consider it.
If that was under consideration, I wasn't part of this conversation.
Okay, well, have you ever thought about it? Does it make any sense, or what would that look like? Could it work? Because these tech companies don't have the business problems that news organizations have, but yet they are carrying news.
Yeah. Well, this gets us down a whole other road, which is
our tech companies,
media companies, and all of that. I mean, you know, if Twitter, and I'm not with Twitter anymore, but if Twitter person was here, they would say, you know, we are an open platform and we want to hear from everybody, including, you know, conflicting points of view, and you can be anonymous and you can share, you're an eyewitness and your identity is protected, and you know, we want to be used, and we are both a tool and we are a distributor for all kinds of news organizations, and if you pick one, you therefore become a competitor to everybody else. So, you know, that would be the argument against. Having said that, I think I'm going to answer a slightly different question than you asked, is to say that, you know, a lot of what the learnings that we've seen from tech companies, not that the New York Times is going to create, when we were there, there was an attempt to create a Facebook-like product. That was a complete disaster.
Why was it a disaster? Why didn't it work?
Because it was, I love Aaron's point of view on this too, because it was trying to create from scratch a community. I think it was already too late, quite honestly. Mm. I mean, Facebook had already taken on a lot of traction. It made a lot of sense, and to create something that was only available on the New York Times site, only to talk to New York Times people, it was too close to community.
I think it would have worked.
Did you have a different point of view?
Not really.
Yeah.
I'm a subscriber to the New York Times, lifetime subscriber to the New York Times. I would have loved that.
Yeah.
Well, I think Twitter is mindless. I think that Facebook's even worse for news. Yeah. And I mean, the New York Times has news down. I think it would have worked. FYI.
A couple of questions here in the front.
So. Hi, so I have a question for Renée. From your research at the FT, which kind of content beyond the classical news article is more useful or engaging or appreciated by your audience?
So I'm going to answer the question by not answering the question. And it's more about methodology than actual results. So if I knew what one piece of content was most desirable to FT subscribers, I would be the CEO and the head of audience engagement. And I'd be really busy. The reality is actually, especially when you've got a relatively premium product, you need to understand that it's actually not one audience, it's an extremely diverse audience. And the trick to the trade, to some extent, is using data and using insights to figure out how to segment that audience more and more and understand the diversity of needs that any one audience might have. And I think, again, you know, a woman, a female audience is the key, is the same example to illustrate that, where you know, our breakdown between male and female in terms of subscribers is not equal. And the needs are quite different in terms of what kind of product is optimal because the usage is different, the industries are different, the seniority level is different, the topics they're most interested in are different. So all of that insight and data we have, it's an understanding how to leverage it and how to test and learn. But it's hard because it's hard for one newsroom to be thinking across multiple different channels of distribution and multiple different kinds of products. So it's not easy, but that's part of the experimentation.
Hi. It's a continuation of the previous thought, really. There seems to be agreement in the panel that there's going to be multiple different revenue streams. Most of you have said that, not all of you. You've also all agreed that journalists need to think more about the business side of things. Any reflections from any of you on how you get journalists when you're talking about multiple revenue streams? What does that mean? Are they all thinking about all the revenue streams? If you obviously have one clear focus, say membership or pay, it might be easy, but if you're talking about a hybrid mix of a whole lot of different things, how do you actually get journalists to engage with that, or how can it be useful for them to get involved?
So it actually is really not easy, even on the membership model. And, you know, I think the problem is that there are choices to be made. So at The Guardian, when we launched or relaunched membership just before last year, they were doing some testing about where people convert, where the best places to convert, and one of the best places, it turns out, actually the best place, was at the bottom of an article. And you might have noticed, as you now read most of these articles online, you'll get that sort of while you're here appeal, and it performed wildly better than any other place on the page. And that previously, and maybe still, is it still there? Mary, is Outbrain still down there? Ish, okay. That previously is where we had Outbrain, okay? So that's a choice. That is a small and growing, very strategic, but we thought arguably crucial future business model, which is membership, versus a very in the moment, right now, Outbrain has £1 million on the table, here it is, you have to make a choice. And unfortunately, those conversations are happening largely without the journalists. Not so much at The Guardian, actually, but I think more broadly. The Guardian, it was a fairly broad discussion. But broadly in these industries, it's happening, these discussions are happening. And in a lot of cases, the long term is losing. Which I think is really, really the biggest problem. Because actually, the journalists are the ones with the most skin in this game. I mean, I hate to say it. If these business models crumble and these organizations go away in a few years, the people on the sales team will find new jobs, the people on the, I mean, that'll happen. The journalists, you know, not sure what's gonna happen there.
I think it's a great question. And there's, again, a good news, bad news answer. The good news is actually journalists, certainly in our newsroom, are asking the question, like, wait, what are we optimizing for? Like, do we want to reach the greatest number? Or do we want to be reaching a specific niche audience? Because they are actually getting mixed messages when you've got kind of a mixed revenue model. The answer, for the most part, that we still give them is both. which they don't particularly like. But our responsibility also as organizations and newsrooms is to figure out how to give journalists a better answer and a better steer to, okay, you're thinking about it, that's great, what should you really be doing? And we're still figuring it out.
Way in the back.
Renée and Turi, I'm sort of quite interested in the way that both of you go around assessing opportunities for whether it speaks to investment or whether it speaks to this is an opportunity for a product that we want to build, which we think satisfies a particular audience. And it would just be interesting to hear a little bit about the methodology that both of you apply on a sort of week-to-week or monthly basis to try and identify and pursue what you should be doing next.
Thanks, Jeremy. One of the tricky things about investing in media is and we're a VC fund, is that in media and technology are very, very different kinds of things. Technology, the ideal technology investment is 16 people in a garage, bought by Facebook for $19 billion. It's a scale play, it's an easy thing to, that power law of returns, which is what determines most VCs' approaches, works for tech and is much harder with media. Every day, as a media company, you start off sort of naked in the wind, trying to get your audience, pushing your content out. You can develop systems which optimize that, and that's part of the things we look for. But it's an iterative process. To answer your question from a VC perspective, I think what we try to find, there are lots of media businesses which should simply not take VC money. They should just grow. If they can take money from the bank, that's the way to grow. You build organic businesses that way. If you are going to take VC, then we're finding those companies. What we're looking for are media companies that can build, I suppose, non-linearity into their business models. And I think we see that non-linearity, if you excuse the phrase, in three possible areas. One, around content. Two, around distribution. And three, around the system, the engine that you build the company on. What do I mean by that? Media businesses which should not take VC money are media businesses which are profitable, which you put $1 in and you get $1.5 out, whatever happens. So you just keep on growing in a linear way. The companies that we're looking for are able to do a sort of geometric progression. And that is, so on the content side, being able to not only produce content which nobody else is doing, but be able to distribute it at a scale and at a cost, which is cleverer than everybody else, and is able to build a system which ties editorial production, all the tech and the data analysis around it, which optimizes the entire process. Sourcing stories, producing stories, packaging stories, distributing stories, and monetizing that whole process. So that, I suppose what we look for is the possibility of a geometric progression in media. That's what we're looking for.
And just very quickly, how we determine opportunities is actually, in some ways, a very traditional biz dev way of doing it. We the newsroom, and sort of via the engagement team, needs to and has to stay aligned with what is the bigger organizational strategy. And in fact, if everyone in the business these days is not aligned, indeed, if the newsroom is not aware of what the marketing, commercial, advertising, and growth strategies are that come down from the top of the commercial pyramid, then we're in trouble. So we take a steer, and we know, well, actually, we're one of the big strategies of the FT is to grow our premium offering. That's a different kind of audience and a different kind of reflection. Even though, at the same time, we do also have to grow more new readers because there's going to be churn. So ultimately, it comes down to being aligned, understanding the breadth of projects that we can be experimenting with around those bigger picture organizational opportunities. And then to quote Mary from The Guardian, who said this on a panel many months ago that we shared, you have to prioritize ruthlessly because you can't do it all.
Just a question about the Guardian's membership, as we have a couple of interested parties on the panel. What do you think of that model where you're both asking people for money and taking advertising as well? And is there a confusion between that model that you're giving it away for free, but you're also asking people to pay in some way?
I'll go first. You know.
I mean, I am a strong, unabashed believer that the Guardian almost uniquely could make a membership model work. And I do mean uniquely. I mean, the Guardian is a singularity. Its ownership model is different than most. Its history is different. It has an enormous global reach. It's an incredible brand. It has an adoring audience, a core audience of readers who find it essential. And 200,000 members really in just the past, 9 months, give or take, I mean, of real honest-to-God effort, maybe a year. I mean, a membership launched in 2014, but it was virtually invisible on the site until very, very recently. So 200,000 paying members, not nothing. So I believe the Guardian's model can work. I think the issue is it goes back to a choice. It is, you know, you can't have both Outbrain and a membership appeal sharing the same space. You cannot undermine the quality. You can't undermine what people value by putting a CNN Money style ad package on every page. And I'm sorry I'm picking on CNN Money because I don't mean to, because it just happens to be one of the more egregious examples. But it does come to a choice. You have to preference one over the other. And that's actually when Renee talks about the way they approach things at the FT, as we were talking about membership, the FT was actually one of the models we looked at. I mean, they are, you know, if I asked you what a quality visit is, how much of the newsroom would know the definition of a quality visit from the FT's point of view?
Probably a lot more now than 18 months ago. But increasingly, it's being aware of a commercial metric even within the journalism.
Yeah. So a quality visit in the context of the FT is a visit. It's not a page view necessarily. It's not a unique. It's a very FT-specific metric that is tied intimately to their business model. That is a level of discipline that doesn't exist at most news organizations. So I think membership could work beautifully at The Guardian, but only in this case where The Guardian really embraces it as their core strategy. And I mean the entire organization, importantly the newsroom. And I think it has a lot. If that happens, I think it can succeed in the way that public media has. But I don't know that it's the model for everybody. In fact, I don't think it's a model for most.
I just want to add two things. First of all, I don't think, and again, I'm not talking about Outbrain kind of style advertising, but I don't think membership and advertising, a different kind of advertising, are incompatible any more than a paid subscription is incompatible with advertising. The right kind of advertising, which I'm not going to attempt to define here. But the other thing I was going to say is I completely agree. First of all, I mentioned it earlier, membership is not for everybody. It absolutely isn't. But I agree that The Guardian is uniquely positioned, and I'm saying that to be able to pull it off. And I say that, again, from my experience at NPR. The reason it works at NPR is you have to have, where it works is because you need people who are so passionate about your product, if you excuse the expression, that they identify themselves as in that way. So, you know, at people at NPR, you know, this is still true today, no doubt, but when I was there, I mean, there were people in who were, this is the days before Tinder, but, you know, in sort of the matchup ads, people would say, you know, I'm an NPR listener. That meant something. When you carry your, you know, the reason NPR gives out the proverbial tote bags for membership, it's not because people desperately need another tote bag. Again, this was in the era before you weren't allowed to have bags at the supermarkets, but because it was a statement about who you are. And The Guardian has all of those same characteristics. If you say, I am a Guardian reader, that says something about you. And you want to say that because you are proud of that affiliation. So that is all the right conditions for membership. But again, not incompatible with the right kind of advertising.
Take maybe one or two more questions, and then I'll do a sort of a lightning round with a panel to wrap up. So just checking if there are any more questions before. So one more question here at the back, and then we'll do the lightning round afterwards.
Hi, my question is for Mr. Kaplan. Are FT journalists ever asked to write the branded content themselves?
Never. is a short answer. So we have a brand content unit, not unlike the T Studio at the Times, called FT Squared, and it is entirely separate from the newsroom, and there's no overlap, and no journalists who write for the FT are producing content for FT Squared, and vice versa.
There are other organizations in which it's shifting. What is your view on that?
To each their own business model, and again, not in a sort of snarky way, but in a sense of to each their own audience, right? And there may be some audiences, and increasingly there are audiences, with whom that kind of slightly blurrier border or a conflation between what is brought to you by and what is born of the newsroom isn't necessarily as relevant. Personally, I think that's a slightly slippery slope, especially when we're already in an ecosystem where it's increasingly complex to discern real news from biased news from lies. So, but again, to each their own business model.
Thank you.
So I threatened the panel in advance that we would end with sort of a lightning round on what's next. We've heard a lot of great questions and some interesting observations from the panel already, but just sort of one observation from each, I suppose. And I'll start so people have a chance to sort of collect their thoughts for this. We left behind a period in history in which almost by accident, news organizations, and primarily really news organizations in a handful of predominantly Protestant countries with shit weather huddled around the North Atlantic, had a monopoly essentially on a control of a river of cash, because they controlled and narrow in that river. And we should remember this was not the case in many, many places, like Italy, for example, where newspapers never grew commercially to be as profitable as they were in the US or in the UK or in Denmark where I'm from. So it wasn't the case everywhere, but in a few places it was, and by virtue of that accident, a lot of advertising money flowed into news. And that accident is over, and it's not coming back. And that's, in one way, really uncomfortable in the sense that there are very real consequences of that for news organizations. Several people in the panel have made that simple point that headcounts are down. Some of you will have seen the Bureau of Labor Statistics numbers that came out of the U.S., the sobering fact that employment in the American newspaper industry, for all the growth in digital over the last 15 years, half of the job force has been cut. So that's the bad news. I suppose the good news might be this. Everybody's got to work for someone. And the question is, who do you work for? And in the past, the answer to that question in a lot of organizations was, on closer inspection, that you worked for your advertisers. And in the future, in some cases, the answer to that question may uncomfortably be that you work for your proprietor. That's not great, necessarily. You know, it could be a benign billionaire. It could also be someone else. It could be that you work for your donors, supporters, members, in some countries your license fee payers. And then for those who can build subscription models, it means that you work for your audience. Ernst-Jan Fout from The Correspondent said on the panel earlier today, our only stakeholders are our readers. That's not, that doesn't make the pain go away of having lost a lot of colleagues and not having the same size newsroom as some organizations had in the not-so-distant past. But that's not a bad place to be, where you work for your readers. So, Turi, we'll go from your side.
I agree with everything Rasmus said. So high level, to pick up your very interesting question around this increasing separation between the haves news and the have-nots news, I've never thought it was a cost issue. I've always thought it was an attention issue. And I think, Rasmus, you framed it as those who care and those who care less. And so perhaps another way of thinking about the changing advertising, business models, et cetera, is to also ask, have we got the products right? And I still think that we're a very long way from having fixed the right products. So in this, as more and more content is available, the truth is fewer and fewer, a smaller percentage of people engage with the news. There's other things to watch. So our job here is to try and work out how we build new formats distributed across new platforms which are truly engaging. And I think we are as far from that as we are from figuring out the business models.
I don't really need to add anything because you said everything that I want to say and agree with. I'll just add one thing, is that it is still an experimentation, and it's an experimentation both from the newsroom perspective of experimenting with formats and forms of distribution, but also from a business perspective and experimenting with packaging and costing. The last thing is that I'm quite optimistic because, as a few of my co-panelists have said, we have to be. And you know, the world has solved business problems before. And journalism has solved business problems many times before, but we have short memories, so I'm optimistic.
I think whatever the future set of solutions are going to be is going to come from the next generation coming into journalism who are digital natives. In many ways, none of us are digital natives. I don't see any digital natives, I think, in the room. And so in that way, we are more similar to, we may be more enlightened, but we are more similar to your 60-year-old who's bemoaning newsprint than we are, you know, than we are to the next generation that's going to come in who have known no other models. And it's going to become, this is my hope and my belief, who are going to figure out the solutions to how to make this all work.
If I can leave with two thoughts, actually I'm going to, three thoughts. One, when you talk about scale in the context of news, it's a sucker's game. There is no organization from The Guardian, 165 million uniques down, that has scale that compares even remotely to the platforms. So any talk about a scale-based model, I believe, is a sucker's game. Number two, there's a lot of wishful thinking in the industry still. There's wishful thinking around print. I totally agree with that. CJR seems to be the propaganda wing for those people. I don't know why all of a sudden. But there's also some wishful thinking going on around display advertising. Recently, there's been some publicity about how now the people are pulling ads, brands are pulling ads from YouTube. Just be really careful about that. Be really careful. Any business model you hear that's based on what you might think is wishful thinking against all the directional, all the numbers that show otherwise, I would say call bullshit on that. And I guess the last thing I will leave you with is this, is that I think that we as journalists need to take a lot more control of this, because one way or another, it's going to happen. If the direction we keep going in is the direction we end up, I mean, it's we know where this story ends, and the only people left to turn out the lights are going to be us. So we might as well get on it now.
So I will do just two things in closing. One is to say to all of you, go home to your colleagues and talk about money. And the other thing I'll ask you to do is to join me in thanking the panelists in this really interesting discussion.
Jason Kent is like, this is great, buy direct, we're back, baby. Yeah. I know.
Like, come on. Yeah. Seriously. Hey. See you again?